The following is a lecture prepared for the Stockton Symphony Insights series, delivered ahead of the symphony's performance of the Sibelius Violin Concerto in January 2020, with Bella Hristova as the soloist. In preparing this talk, I consulted a professional violinist, Miriam Cotan-Rack, about the technical demands of this concerto that is well known for its virtuosic challenges. Her comments are sprinkled throughout the talk. Miriam has been a friend and fellow wine taster for many years. She's a superb violinist and violin teacher. Thank you, Miriam, for your valuable opinions. We will begin with a quote from Burnett James. The violin concerto is in more than one sense a compensation for or a sublimation of Sibelius's unfulfilled ambition to become a virtuoso international violinist. Yes, Sibelius was a frustrated violinist. Let's begin with a biography of this remarkable composer. A warning, I will use the word finish quite frequently. I am not referring to something completed, but rather to the country of Finland. Finnish, someone from Finland. Jean Sibelius biography. Jean Sibelius was born December 8, 1865 in Hamelina, Finland, to Swedish-speaking parents. His father, a doctor, died in 1868, bankrupt. Mother moved in with extended family. He was introduced to music by his aunt Evelina and began piano lessons at age 8, violin lessons at age 15. As indicated before, he aspired to become a violin virtuoso. It was not to be. I'll have more to say on that later. His real first name was Jana, a version of Johann. During his high school years, he changed it to the more French-sounding Jean. Sibelius studied music at the Helsinki Music Institute, 1885 to 89, in Berlin, 1889 to 90, and Vienna, 1890 to 91. In 1892, he married Ino Jornfeld, who was to be his steadfast companion for the rest of his life. They built a home in the countryside outside Helsinki that they entitled Ainola, in Järvenpää on Lake Tuusula. Sibelius lived there from 1904 for the rest of his life. Around this time, Sibelius took to heavy drinking, carousing, and excessive spending. Like his father, his finances were precarious. In 1899, Kullervo, a nationalistic choral symphony, gave Sibelius his first recognition. Sibelius's nationalistic music, based on Finnish myth, continued with Karelia Suite, 1893, four tone poems on the legendary hero Lemminkainen, 1895, and Finlandia, 1899. Symphonies number 1 and 2 followed soon thereafter in 1899 and 1902. His violin concerto premiered in 1904 amid debt and drinking in the composer's life. Difficulties with the concerto led to more bouts of drinking. The revision of the concerto was a turbulent process. The revised version premiered in 1905. I'll have more to say on the history of the concerto later. Between 1907 and 1909, Sibelius went through a throat cancer scare. He had a series of throat surgeries and a tumor was removed. This caused Sibelius to quit smoking and drinking. Symphonies No. 3 through 7 premiered in 1907, 1911, 1915, 1923, and 1924, respectively. In 1926, Sibelius stopped composing. He lived for another 30 years. This long dry spell is referred to as the silence of Järvenpää, the town where he lived. Sibelius did attempt an eighth symphony, but after 5 years he gave up and destroyed all documents related to this work. In the 1930s, Sibelius's music was extremely popular. For example, a survey of the New York Philharmonic audience revealed Sibelius to be their most popular composer. Sibelius is considered a hero in Finland, father of Finnish concert music. December 8, his birthday, is celebrated as Flag Day, also referred to as Day of Finnish Music. Sibelius died September 20, 1957, at age 91. Sibelius and the Violin. The Violin Concerto is Sibelius's only work for solo instrument and orchestra. Michael Steinberg points out that while most keyboard concertos were written for composers for themselves, many violin concertos were written for others. In this regard, Sibelius's concerto stands out as unique. Sibelius, says Steinberg, wrote his for a kind of ghostly self. He was a failed violinist. Sibelius began seriously studying the violin in the autumn of 1881 at age 15. He aspired to become a violin virtuoso. A quote from Sibelius, 1883, quote, "When I play the violin, I am filled with a strange feeling. It is as though the insides of the music opened up to me," unquote. Between 1886 and 1891, Sibelius played the violin in various orchestras and chamber ensembles in Helsinki and Vienna. His violin aspirations were dashed in January 1891 when he auditioned for the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra and was rejected. Sibelius biographer Eric Tawasierna says, when he got back to his room, Sibelius broke down and wept. There were various factors that led to his failure as a violinist, among them the late age of start and inadequate resources in Finland for such a purpose. Furthermore, says Michael Steinberg, he had neither the physical coordination nor the temperament for such a career. Another quote from Sibelius. "My tragedy was that I wanted to be a celebrated violinist at any price. It was a very painful awakening when I had to admit that I had begun my training for the exacting career of a virtuoso too late." Sibelius's violin concerto is, quote, "imbued with his feelings for the instrument and the pain of his farewell to his overriding ambition," unquote. This is also from Michael Steinberg. And now we come back to my first quote by Burnett James. The violin concerto is in more than one sense a compensation for or a sublimation of Sibelius's unfulfilled ambition to become a virtuoso international violinist. Sibelius the composer. A brief overview of the compositional career of Sibelius. Sibelius was mainly a composer of orchestral works, mostly symphonies and tone poems. He composed seven numbered symphonies. Some classify his choral work Kullervo of 1893 and orchestral suite Lemminkainen of 1895, both based on Finnish national myth Kalevala, as symphonies. His tone poem Finlandia, 1899, one of his most popular works, is a cornerstone of Finnish nationalism. During his long career, his style evolved from Viennese classical and early romantic to neoclassical, then expressionist, and finally novel 20th century works that cannot be pegged. We find his violin concerto in the classical and early romantic phase of Sibelius's development. History of the violin concerto. The concerto had a long and tortuous birth with some unexpected twists and turns. The early history of the concerto is inextricably tied to a then-famous German violinist for whom the concerto was written and who ended up never playing the concerto. His name is Willy Burmaster, 1869 to 1933. Sibelius knew Burmaster from a stint the violinist had done as a concertmaster in Helsinki. Sibelius began work on the concerto September 1902 after visiting Burmaster in Berlin. Scholars think that Burmaster most likely inspired Sibelius to compose the piece. A year later, by September 1903, the first two movements were ready in piano score. Sibelius soon completed the third movement and orchestration by December 1903. Sibelius sent the score to Burmaster. It was to be dedicated to him. Burmaster: wonderful, masterly. Only once before have I spoken in such terms to a composer, and that was when Tchaikovsky showed me his concerto. In short order, within less than 2 years, Burmaster was to boycott his friend's concerto and never play it for the rest of his career. Perhaps for financial reasons, Sibelius pushed for an early premiere of his violin concerto. Burmaster was unavailable and didn't have enough time to learn the piece. So the premiere occurred February 8, 1904 in Helsinki, with Viktor Novacek as soloist and Sibelius conducting the Helsingfors Philharmonic Orchestra. Novacek was a violin teacher at the Helsinki Music Institute. He did not have any reputation as a performer, nor did he possess the capability to perform what turned out to be a technically challenging concerto. The premiere was a disaster. Erik Tawatsierna, Sibelius' biographer, recounts, quote, "A red-faced and perspiring Viktor Novacek fought a losing battle with a solo part that bristled with even greater difficulties than in the definitive score," unquote. While there were some favorable reviews, the concerto was doomed by an extremely negative review by Carl Floden, who at the time was the foremost music critic of Finland. Very few people attended the second and third performances. Floden had plenty criticism of the composition, but he especially singled out Novacek's performance. Quote, "His playing offered up a mass of joyless things. From time to time, there were terrible sounds, and it was impossible to fathom the composer's meaning. So great was the cacophony," unquote. Another criticism came from Joseph Joachim, 1831 to 1907, the famous German violinist, and in those days, a towering figure in Europe. He considered Sibelius's violin concerto schlusslos and langweilig, dreadful and boring. Joachim never changed his mind. And so Sibelius withdrew the concerto and revised it, completing the new score by June 1905. Willy Burmaster offered his services again in 1904. Again, he was passed over, this time because Sibelius received an offer from his publisher for stellar performance for the new premiere. This is when a furious Burmaster boycotted the work. The premiere of the new version occurred October 19, 1905, in Berlin, with Karl Haller as soloist and the great Richard Strauss conducting the Berlin Philharmonic. Haller had previously premiered Tchaikovsky's violin concerto. This revised version is the one in the repertoire, the one we will listen to in this talk. In 1905, Sibelius forbade performance of the original version. Early reactions to both the Berlin premiere and subsequent 1906 performances in Helsinki, St. Petersburg, and New York were mixed and lukewarm. Among early champions of the concerto was a 17-year-old Hungarian prodigy, Ferenc von Vexé, who performed the work in Berlin and Vienna. Sibelius eventually dedicated the concerto to von Vexé. There is a good deal of scholarly examination of Sibelius's rude treatment of Burmaster. Numerous theories abound. The truth is that we'll never know exactly why Sibelius treated Burmaster in such a shabby fashion. Writing soon after the 1905 premiere of the revised concerto, music scholar and critic Sir Donald Tovey said, "Perhaps the violin concerto of Sibelius has not yet had time to become popular." He then prophesied, "But I cannot see any reason why it should not soon take place with the concertos of Mendelssohn and Bruch as one of the three most attractive concertos ever written." Like Beethoven's violin concerto, the Sibelius work languished in relative obscurity for nearly two decades. Eventually, beginning in the 1930s, the concerto was popularized by Jascha Heifetz and acquired its place in the current repertoire. Quote, "As in the case of Beethoven's violin concerto, it took a long time before Sibelius's work obtained its well-deserved place in the repertoire," unquote. Erki Salmenhara is a musicologist from Finland. Incidentally, for a detailed review of Beethoven's violin concerto, you can check out my podcast on the subject in YouTube or my website, morissenegor.com. A postscript. In the 1990s, Sibelius's heirs allowed the recording and performance of the original 1904 version of the concerto. This has spawned various scholarly comparisons between the original and revised versions. We will mostly stay out of this discussion, for this is not within the scope of this talk. Suffice it to say that most critics and scholars consider the revised version to be the superior one. Overview of the Sibelius Violin Concerto. Movement 1, Allegro Moderato. It is in sonata form, key of D minor, mostly 2-2 meter, some in 6-4 and 4-4. In his score, Sibelius subdivides the movement into six subsections: Allegro moderato, molto moderato tranquillo, allegro molto, moderato assai, allegro moderato, and allegro molto vivace. Note that these subsections have nothing to do with the sonata form narrative of the music. Rather, they mark changes in meter or tempo, a frequent occurrence in the movement. Movement 2, Adagio di Molto, ternary form, ABA, key of B flat major, 4-4 time. Movement 3, Allegro ma non tanto, ABAB, key of D major, 3-4 time. Movement 1. This is a classically structured sonata form movement with an exposition, development, and recapitulation. It ends with a tiny coda. Exposition. Classical era concertos, such as those of Haydn or Mozart, featured a double exposition in their sonata form first movements. That is, a separate exposition for the orchestra, and this came first, and another one for the solo instrument, this followed. Beginning with Beethoven's Piano Concerto No. 5 of 1809, this tradition disappeared, and in the Romantic era that followed, the first movement of concertos began with a single exposition, as in symphonies. While Sibelius's sonata structure resembles a classical era movement in its proportions, it has a single exposition in keeping with Romantic era tradition. The exposition features what is expected: a theme 1 complex, theme 2 complex, and closing section. Allegro moderato, theme 1 complex, D minor, 2-2 time. A quiet ostinato in muted strings creates a shimmering musical background. An ostinato is a recurring musical idea, usually in the bass. Against this accompaniment, the solo violin presents a theme 1 complex. Theme 1 is a fairly extended melody. It is followed by a mini cadenza by solo violin. We will eventually listen to all this in due course, but for now, I divided it to four distinct parts so that we can swallow it more easily. Part one is a lyrical, song-like melody, a sensitive, dreamy melody that introduces the voice of the soloist, says Michael Steinberg. The melody is hauntingly echoed by a clarinet. Let's hear it. The first three notes of this melody represent the most important motive of the movement, a rising-falling idea, a long note followed by a fast turn of phrase. Here it is. In part two, the theme takes a darker turn, with the violin playing virtuosically, first on the G string only, then on the A string. Dark woodwind echoes and a quiet, steady timpani roll accompany. The shimmering strings are still there. Note that there are four strings on the violin, from left to right and low to high, G, D, A, E. The G string motive is a fast, jagged melody with a distinct, dotted rhythm. The A string motive is a smoother, chromatic melody with a short, long rhythm. Here they are. G string. A string. These two motives will be prominently featured in the development. In part three, the violin engages in a series of rising scales and reaches an impassioned climax. The climax is cut off abruptly by two fast, dissonant orchestral chords, as if the music is chopped off by a pair of scissors. Here it is. Mini cadenza by the solo violin. At this point, the solo violin presents a fast and virtuosic mini cadenza. A cadenza is a section of music where the soloist plays alone. The cadenza is a long-standing tradition in concertos and usually occurs right before the end of all first movements. Some composers also have cadenzas in their second and third movements, once again, usually towards the end. In the classical era, the cadenza was improvised. In other words, it was left up to the player. Beginning with Beethoven's seminal Piano Concerto No. 5, the cadenza became a through-composed passage. However, with few exceptions, its position in the first movement did not change, still towards the end. Therefore, it is unusual to encounter a cadenza amid theme one. But there you have it. Sibelius, as you'll soon discover, has some novel ideas on how to deploy a cadenza. He sprinkles the movement with various cadenzas in unexpected places. The first mini cadenza begins with a burst of 16th note scales marked veloce, rapid, in the score. A quiet, steady timpani roll accompanies. Violinist Miriam Cotin-Rack comments that this is a demanding passage, fast and on one string, requiring continuous shifting of the player's finger up and down the string. The cadenza continues with what Michael Steinberg calls a super violinistic recitation of sixths and octaves with frequent double stops. A double stop is two notes played simultaneously. The passage ends with a dramatic crescendo, the violin soaring up three octaves before handing the music over to the orchestra. Here is the mini cadenza. This brief but rather dramatic cadenza at the very outset of the concerto is a calling card. It announces the technically challenging nature of the piece, a feature the concerto is well known for. Now we're ready to listen to the entire Theme 1 complex with the mini cadenza that follows. Shimmering ostinato. Theme 1, Part 1. Part 2, G string melody. A string melody. Part 3. Loud chord, mini cadenza, the music now moves on to the next section that Sibelius entitles Molto Moderato e Tranquillo in B-flat major to D-flat major and in 6-4 time. This is a theme 2 complex. Note that this music flows steadily with momentum and there is no musical indication from one section to another that we're listening to a new section. Such musical indications are quite common with the classical era composers such as Mozart or Haydn. They make it easy for the listener to follow the various subsections of the movement. In the Romantic era, these disappear and the music just flows. Thus, if you don't listen to talks such as this, it is hard to keep up with where you are in the narrative, at least upon first listening. In this, the theme 2 complex, Sibelius changes the meter from 2-2 to 6-4 and the key area from minor to mostly major, B major to D major. Incidentally, 6-4, a rather unusual meter, was Sibelius's favorite. He employed this in many of his compositions. Also note that so far the solo violin has been virtually the only voice in the work completely dominating the theme 1 complex. Now, with theme 2, the orchestra gets a piece of the action. Theme 2 is derived from theme 1. The initial presentation of the theme is in low strings and winds, and it is a dark-hued melody. The solo violin then delivers a stunningly beautiful, rhythmically altered version of the theme. Its emotional effect is so different that at first hearing, the tune seems unrelated to the earlier orchestral version. Finally, the solo violin transitions with a preview of the upcoming closing theme. We will listen to this section in two musical examples. First, the orchestral and solo violin versions of the theme. The dark-hued theme 2 melody, B-flat, D minor, is initially mezzo forte in low strings and low winds. It is repeated twice. The orchestra then trails off, leaving bassoon and horns to quietly announce a variation on the tune that foreshadows the solo violin passage to follow. Solo violin enters in B-flat major with an operatic scale that soars. It then presents the gorgeous version of theme 2 in D-flat major in a passage marked affettuoso, affectionate, with tender warmth in the score. The violin starts its song in high register and switches to low register as the tune winds down and fades away, with pizzicato strings accenting the end. Theme 2 in orchestra. Bassoon and horns preview the violin version. Violin starts with operatic scale. Violin version of theme 2. Now, the transitional violin passage that will preview the upcoming closing theme. This passage has been labeled a cadenza by various scholars, and so I too am calling it a cadenza. Strictly speaking, it is not a true cadenza because there are orchestral elements in the accompaniment. Nevertheless, the solo violin is quite dominant, so much so that the passage does sound like a cadenza. I divided the transitional cadenza into two parts. In part one, the solo violin engages in a dramatic rising scale. It then previews what will soon be the closing theme. The accompaniment is a quiet pedal in strings and timpani. A pedal is a sustained note or chord, usually in accompaniment. The key area is still B-flat major, the meter 6-4. In part two, the solo violin begins a sustained trill on the E string. Once again, the E string is the highest sounding string on the instrument. At the beginning of the trill, the closing theme is echoed pizzicato in strings. Solo violin then echoes the pizzicato strings while holding the trill. After this, a brief transitional passage leads to the closing section. Here is the transitional cadenza. Mm-hmm. Note that in part two, the solo violin simultaneously held a trill in the E string and played a melody in the A string. According to violinist Miriam Cotan-Rack, this is actually not all that difficult. Allegro molto, the closing section. The meter changes to 2-2, key area is B-flat minor. This dramatic section is assigned entirely to the orchestra. The soloist takes a break. The music is typical Sibelius, dark-hued and bleak. It features two closing themes. A tiny bit of sunshine amid the desolation presented by the woodwinds is quickly crushed. The section comes to a morose, tragic end. First closing theme C1 is a loud, dark-hued melody in violins with full orchestral accompaniment, creating a thick texture that contributes to the tragic feel of the melody. There are steady pedals in winds and horns and a two-note ostinato in low strings. The score asks for marcatissimo, very strong accentuation. Toward the end, the theme is highlighted by a trombone fanfare that adds a tragic touch to the music. Cheerful wind variation on C1. A sudden bright spot, as if the clouds parted. Flutes play a dense, like rustic variation of the C1 theme. Brass and timpani issue an abrupt response. Now, the entire wind section energetically takes up this bright tune. Towards the end, the passage is accented by repeated brass timpani gestures. The passage ends with a crescendo toward a brass climax. Closing theme number 2, C2. A fortissimo, jagged, rising-falling melody and trumpets and trombones appear at the climax. It reestablishes the tragic mood. C2 reappears in horns in a diminuendo passage. The music exhausts itself. A resigned, dejected, quiet variation of C2 appears in slow tempo in bassoons. It is a despairing cadence theme, says Donald Tovey. The dejected mood continues with the tune and basses, the music fragmenting and fading away in a morendo, dying passage. And thus, the exposition ends in a tragic note, in utter darkness, says Donald Tovey. Here's the closing section. First closing theme, C1. Cheerful wind variation. Resigned, dejected music. Morendo passage. Moderato assai, development. The meter changes to 4-4, key area is G minor. The development is brief but striking. It consists of an unprecedented gesture. The entire section is a solo violin cadenza. Once again, in the first movement, the cadenza is expected to occur towards the end of the movement, right before the coda. A cadenza in the middle of the movement is unusual. A cadenza that entirely replaces development was unheard of. I'll have more to say on this subject after we finish listening to the first movement. The cadenza consists of variations of theme one motives amid virtuosic figurations. Two motives in particular are easily audible. These are the G string and A string melodies from part two of theme one. Let's hear these again. First, the G string melody. This will be elaborately developed twice, easily heard. Now, the A string melody. This melody dominates the development and is heard in four variations. The development cadenza begins with a three-octave rise of two notes, from low B to high B. It sounds like a scream or an outcry. A cry of protest to the preceding turbulent climax, says David Hurwitz, who wrote a book about Sibelius. Solo violin then engages in a rapid series of arpeggios and scales, ending in a final soaring scale and a sustained high D. Next is the first version of the A string melody from theme one, part two, stated by the violin in low register and in A minor. The drop in register and minor key imbues the music with melancholy. A loud and abrupt angry gesture from orchestra is reminiscent of the one that occurred in the exposition. The violin responds with a series of fast arpeggios and scales. It then restates the A string melody in variation. This is followed by an extended development of the G string melody. Two more A string melody variations follow. Then comes an extended development of the G string melody. Finally, a virtuosic passage with double and triple stops and difficult jumps up and down the strings returns to the key of G minor. The solo violin continues its recitation while bassoons initiate a sneaky recapitulation in the bass. Here is the development cadenza. Outcry. Virtuosic passage. A string melody. Angry gesture. A string melody. G string melody developed. Two more A string melodies. Extended development of G string melody. Thank you. Recapitulation in the Bass by Bassoons. Notice how smoothly the music flowed into recapitulation, a very understated beginning of recap. Allegro moderato. In recapitulation, the meter changes to 2-2, recap begins in G minor. The recap consists of the same sequence of events as the exposition. However, every section is reworked and varied. The early mini cadenza of the exposition that occurred immediately after the solo violin presentation of theme 1 is replaced by a mini development section. The recapitulation ends with a brief coda that concludes the movement. Theme 1. Parts 1 and 2, as you just heard, recap begins quietly with bassoon stating theme 1 beneath ongoing solo violin figurations. The solo violin then quietly takes up the theme in low register, bassoons switching to accompaniment. It embarks upon a more elaborate, embellished presentation of the theme, the passage gradually becoming louder and more impassioned. Part 3. Solo violin takes up a motive of the theme and through a series of rising scales brings it to a passionate climax. This passage is louder and more dramatic than its exposition counterpart. The orchestra then intervenes. This is analogous to the abrupt, scissor-like gesture of the exposition. Here in recap, it is not abrupt. It is a new motive derived from the theme in low winds and horns, heralding a development of the theme. At this point in the exposition, there was a mini cadenza presented by the solo violin. Instead, a mini development of the theme occurs in orchestra. Quote, a new and impassioned development with rich modulations, Donald Tovey. The new motive of theme 1 is at first developed by horns and low winds. Then, with a key change from G minor to D major, the music rises to a huge orchestral climax, accentuated by loud trombone fanfares and timpani rolls. The climax calms down in a diminuendo that leads to theme 2. Here is recapitulation theme 1 complex and its developmental conclusion. Recap in bassoons. Violin takes up theme 1, parts 1 and 2. This is part 1. Part 2. Part 3. Orchestral gesture. Orchestral development. Thank you. diminuendo will lead to theme two. Notice that unlike the exposition, the orchestra got a significant piece of the action here in theme one. What it did was to develop the theme, a task that was denied to the orchestra by the cadenza that occurred in the actual development. Theme two and the transitional cadenza. Theme two is initially presented in a calm passage that settles the mood of the prior climax. The passage is somewhat developmental. It begins with a motive of the theme in oboe that is then echoed successively in strings and clarinet. Note that this calm section is the counterpart of the dark-hued, turgid orchestral version of the exposition. Solo violin then enters with a dolce song that ends with a soaring scale. The violin follows with a gorgeous, affettuoso version of the theme. The passage begins in D major in high register, but then darkens to D minor in low register. The passage fades in a diminuendo. Overall, the violin presentation of theme two is more elaborate and impassioned than its exposition counterpart. The brief transitional cadenza that announced the upcoming closing theme returns in D minor and 2-2 time, as opposed to B flat minor and 6-4 of the exposition. The passage begins with a solo violin playing an upward scale that soars. It then previews the closing theme. The long trill follows. Beneath the trill, pizzicato strings echo the closing theme twice. Note a small detail in this last gesture. Unlike its exposition counterpart, the solo violin simply maintains the trill and does not simultaneously echo the theme. The second echo is assigned to pizzicato strings. Also, as I indicated before, this is not a true cadenza. There is accompaniment by orchestra, albeit quiet. Let's hear theme two and transitional cadenza of the recap. Theme two begins with a calm passage. Solo violin, dolce passage. Solo violin, affettuoso, theme two. Transitional cadenza. Allegro molto vivace, closing section and coda. In this, the final section of the movement, there is no change in key or meter. They remain D minor and 2-2. The change is in tempo. Led by solo violin, the music suddenly picks up a fast, dance-like tempo that keeps up until the end. Unlike the earlier closing section, which ended on a tragic note, this one is fast and upbeat. The solo violin suddenly picks up the tempo in a crescendo, engaging in fast, virtuosic figurations. The music sounds like a gypsy dance. Toward the end of its fast passage, solo violin prefigures closing theme C1. The cheerful wind variation of C1 appears in flute, then clarinet. Solo violin accompanies with fast, virtuosic figurations. And after another fast virtuosic passage from solo violin, the previously morose second closing theme appears in low woodwinds, repeated twice. Solo violin accompanies. Note that unlike its earlier version that ended the exposition on a tragic note, this version of C2 is merely a recall with no emotional impact. The coda is brief. Solo violin engages in a rising scale at the end of which it recalls the main motive of theme 1. A fast passage with two more rising scales from violin brings the movement to an upbeat finale. Sir Donald Tovey comments on this ending of the first movement. Brilliance is an inadequate term. Solo violin breaks into C1. Cheerful wind variation. Coda. Some comments about the first movement. Classicism. The sonata form structure of the movement is proportioned in a way that harkens back to the classical era of Haydn and Mozart, exposition and recapitulation occupying most of it. The development is relatively brief, and the coda a tiny piece of concluding music. As I previously indicated, however, classical era concertos featured double expositions. This one does not. In this regard, it adheres to Romantic era tradition. About the mid-movement cadenza. Sibelius was inspired by Mendelssohn's violin concerto of 1844. Musicologist Glenda Goss says, cadenzas often give the feeling of being tacked on. Seldom have they been integrated to the work. Mendelssohn, in his violin concerto, tackled this problem by placing his first movement cadenza at the end of development. Sibelius takes it one step further, replacing the entire development with a cadenza. Note that the original 1904 version of the concerto featured two cadenzas, the second akin to a Bach chaconne, technically very difficult. In the final 1905 version, this was deleted. The result, says Glenda Goss, was that the balance shifted the cadenza, the true moment of violinistic flamboyance, and the cadenza became the centerpiece of the entire movement. One more point about the development. Sibelius compensates for his substitution of a cadenza in lieu of development by inserting various developmental passages into the recapitulation. These collectively represent the missing development. Climaxes. David Hurwitz points out that the climax that goes wrong or self-destructs is a common feature of Sibelius's music, a dramatic device he shares with Mahler. Examples include the climax at the end of the violin recitation of theme 1, the climax at the end of the closing section, and the climax at the end of the theme 1 recap. Balance between solo violin and orchestra. The movement does not try to integrate the soloist and orchestra in the manner of Beethoven or Brahms. The solo violin is clearly the dominant element of the movement, the diva. This is most evident in the very beginning, where it states theme 1 in a lengthy passage. The development cadenza and the various other mini-cadenzas add to this effect. Glenda Goss. He conceived the movement from the point of view of the broken-hearted, thwarted violinist longing for the virtuoso career that would never be. The soloist plays almost nonstop from the first bar to the last. Subdivisions of the movement and frequent meter changes. Meter changes within a movement is a modern phenomenon, mostly in the 20th century. In this regard, the concerto is an early example of this trend. Virtuosity and technical challenges. Examples of virtuosic demands include fast runs of scales, arpeggios and octaves, double and triple stops, fast scales on a single string, and fast passages requiring difficult finger positions. Violinist Miriam Cotan Rack points out that each one of these techniques is not in and of itself challenging to the professional violinist. It is the high frequency and fast tempo of these elements, often lined up back to back, that makes the concerto technically demanding. Furthermore, the length of the movement, with its frequent technical passages, presents a major challenge to the stamina of the player. Movement 2. The slow movement is a relatively brief lyrical interlude with a ternary structure, A-B, A-prime, coda. The music remains static, with B-flat major as the key area and a steady 4-4 meter. The movement begins with an introductory gesture. Clarinets state a brief melody based on a three-note motive. This is very similar to theme 1 of movement 1, with an identical rhythmic profile. The melody is then repeated in oboe, sequenced up. Sequencing is playing the same musical idea in a different register, in this case, higher. The oboe then begins another version, sequenced yet higher. This is taken up by the rest of the winds and extended. A brief transitional passage in bassoons leads to section A of the ternary structure. Let's hear the similarity between the opening of this movement and that of the first. We'll hear the rising three-note motive of the solo violin in the first movement and the rising three-note motive of the clarinet here, back-to-back. Notice the identical long-short-long rhythmic profile of both. First movement, theme 1. Second movement, introduction. This is called thematic unity, a motive from the beginning spawning another in a different movement. The introduction you just heard will give rise to the main themes of sections A and B of the movement. Therefore, they are all tied to the first movement opening. This sort of thematic unity is very Germanic, common in the music of Beethoven or Brahms. In this regard, we're catching Sibelius in his early phase, where he adhered to classical and early romantic musical procedures. As his career advanced, Sibelius gave up this sort of thematic unity, preferring instead to assemble big, elaborate melodies from multiple fragments presented early in the movement. Section A. The main theme of this section, which I'll call Theme A, is a lovely lyrical song weaved sonoro ed expressivo, sonorous and expressive, by the solo violin. The main motive of this theme A, heard at the very beginning, is an inversion of the introductory gesture we just heard. An inversion is playing the notes backwards, or in the score, upside down. The accompaniment is gentle and syncopated in winds and strings. In its second half, the melody rises and becomes more passionate. It ends in a hesitant codetta. the musical equivalent of a shy stammer, comments David Hurwitz. Here is Section A. Theme A. Melody becomes more passionate. Codetta. David Hurwitz comments that this violin melody has been likened to the slow movement theme of Beethoven's Piano Concerto No. 5. Michael Steinberg agrees, quote, "The world and gestures evoked are the world and gestures of Beethoven," unquote. Edward Downes has a different take, a deep-throated song of almost Tchaikovskian melancholy. Finally, Steinberg again. Sibelius never found, perhaps never sought, such a melody again. As you just heard, the A section was owned by the solo violin. The middle section, B, is shared by orchestra and violin. There are two musical ideas in this section that I labeled themes B and B prime. We'll hear these first and then examine the B section in more detail. Theme B begins in orchestra. It is the very same theme as that of the introductory gesture, but now it is transformed into a dark-hued melody in strings. It is then sequenced up. Let's compare this theme to the introductory gesture in clarinet and then oboe. I'll play the introductory gesture first, then theme B. Notice that they're identical. Prime is a counter melody derived from theme B. It initially appears as a fortissimo brass wind response to theme B. About B prime, David Hurwitz says, "A brilliant interjection of the trumpets in that high, piercing register that Sibelius always turns to when he wants to create extreme tension." Now we can proceed with a description of the middle B section of the movement. It begins with theme B in strings. Theme B is sequenced up. It then receives a B prime response from brass and winds. This series of melodies is repeated in variation. Theme B, B sequenced up, theme B prime. B prime is extended. At this point, the solo violin enters with its own extended version of B prime. The passage is dark-hued and at times dissonant. Note that this violin passage features two melodies played simultaneously, one in duple meter, the other in triple meter. It is one of the more challenging passages of the concerto. Let's get this in our ears. Miriam Cotin-Rack calls this passage a duet integrated to the violin part. David Hurwitz comments, but it comes across, hopefully, as purely beautiful and totally natural. The B section ends with transitional music, a rising polyphonic passage. Orchestra presents a melody derived from theme A motive, while the solo violin engages in virtuosic scales. This transition that flows into the return of section A. Here is the entire B section. I will narrate. Theme B. B sequenced up. B prime. Theme B. B sequenced up. B prime extended. Solo violin, B prime. Two melodies played simultaneously. Transitional music, orchestra. You just heard the beginning of the A prime section, the da capo, the return to the A to the beginning. Remember that the original theme A was entirely in solo violin. Here in A prime, theme A returns in orchestra and in variation. The melody is presented by the horns, solo violin accompanying with scale figurations and arpeggios. The theme is restless and agitated and rises in a crescendo. It then calms on a solo violin interlude with a series of triplets based on a theme A motive. The interlude continues with the same theme A motive quietly in horns, the music accented by falling figures in high woodwinds that sound like bird calls. Orchestral presentation of theme A comes to a rousing conclusion after a slow crescendo. A brief coda concludes the movement. Here, the music falls to mezzo forte, and the solo violin states the shy, stammering codetta of the first A section. It then briefly restates theme A dolce, sweetly, in a passage that recalls the beginning of the movement. A horn chorale ushers in the concluding remarks by the solo violin that slowly fade away. The movement ends poignantly, with solo violin rising to and holding a high C, while orchestral strings utter two plagal amen cadences. Here is section A prime and coda. Theme A in orchestra. Solo violin interlude. theme and horns. Rousing conclusion. Coda begins with the codetta. Solo violin, dolce, theme A. Horn chorale. Violin rises to a high C. Amen. Amen. A brief poetic coda, says David Hurwitz. Musicologist Burnett James comments, "There is a note of nostalgia in this slow movement that is quite uncharacteristic of Sibelius." James interprets this as the composer's melancholy over his shattered dream of becoming a violin virtuoso. Movement 3. This movement was revised by Sibelius from rondo to sonata form without development. Thus, it can be viewed as A, B, A prime, B prime. Section A in D major and 3/4 time. The movement begins with a chugging rhythm in strings and timpani. This will be the ostinato that accompanies theme one. Theme one in solo violin, marked energico in the score, energetically, is a fast, dance-like melody with a characteristic rhythm derived from the ostinato that accompanies it. Solo violin presents the theme first in low register, then in high. In order to make the theme audible, the accompaniment is cut to chamber music size. Two violas, two cellos, a single bass, and timpani. They all play softly. Here is theme one. Chugging rhythm. Solo violin, theme one, low register. High register. This tune was famously described by Sir Donald Tovey as Polonaise for Polar Bears. It is a phrase that is quoted in every scholarly paper and symphony program. A brief counter melody in low register is followed by virtuosic figurations by solo violin ending in a trill. Violinist Miriam Cotan-Rack comments about the demands of this passage. It gets more difficult as the passage progresses. Fast runs of scales, a staccato rising scale at measure 27, tough to execute properly, constant string crossings, all one after the other in a short time. You don't have time to breathe, says Miriam. The music flows with no break in momentum into section B. This is in G minor to D major and 3/4 time triple meter. In an introductory gesture, the mood abruptly changes as the orchestra takes over in G minor. Low winds and horns preview the upcoming theme, while strings declare a new ostinato with a distinctive rhythm. Theme 2 is then presented by low strings. It is another dance-like melody, but with a dark hue. The rhythm of this melody alternates between twice 3 and thrice 2. This is called a hemiola. Let's listen to it, and then I'll discuss it further. Introductory gesture. Theme 2. The thrice two part of the melody is called a hemiola, so it goes something like this: 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 1 2 1 2. Hemiolas usually occur in triple meter music. A hemiola is a temporary change in the beat from triple to duple, usually accomplished by a change in the time value of the notes. A hemiola is a rhythmic illusion. It gives the listener an impression of a change in meter, even though there is none. Donald Tovey comments about this rhythm. Known to Couperin, Bach, and Handel as that of triple time with the hemiol, as in a French courant, but taken by Sibelius at a pace altogether shocking to 18th century dancers of courants. The courant, by the way, is a slow triple meter dance from the Renaissance and Baroque. It was popular in France and Italy. The French version frequently employed hemiolas. Section B continues with two theme two variations in solo violin and what else? Another virtuosic violin passage, of course. It ends with a massive orchestral climax. In the first solo violin variation, the soloist picks up the tune in a brief, dynamic, syncopated version. In the second, the solo violin proceeds with its own version of theme two in double and triple stops. Despite the embellishment, the melody remains faithful to the orchestral version. A brief passage of fast, virtuosic solo violin figurations follows. Now, a key change back to D major. The music quiets down and a motivic fragment of theme two appears in various instrument groups while solo violin weaves rapid arpeggios. The section ends with a massive orchestral climax. Amid the blaring brass and timpani rolls, winds and strings preview theme one that is about to make a comeback. Here is the remainder of the B section. First variation in violin. Second variation, theme repeated. Fast virtuosic passage. Key change to D major. Motivic fragments of theme two. Music moves towards massive orchestral climax. Thank you. prime in D major and 3/4 time. The climax abruptly gives way to the solo violin, which restates theme 1 with a steady beating accompaniment in strings. This is the high register version. The chugging accompaniment of the earlier A section returns as the solo violin moves on to the low register version of the theme. The remainder of theme 1 in solo violin is vigorous and virtuosic and faithful to the earlier version. A prime is shorter than its earlier version. It ends in a small crescendo, and the momentum of the music continues towards B prime. Section B prime in D minor and 3/4 time. The orchestra takes over with a key change to D minor and restates the introductory gesture previewing theme 2. Theme 2 is then stated by the bassoon G major with a persistent chugging rhythm in orchestra. Solo violin accompanies in high register. Note that the solo violin in accompaniment sounds as though the instrument is whistling a bird song. This is accomplished with a technique entitled artificial harmonics. Let's listen and pay careful attention to the solo violin in accompaniment. We'll say a bit more about it afterwards. Introductory gesture. Theme in bassoon. Violin starts its accompaniment. Artificial harmonics, bird song-like. Harmonics are overtones of the string that produce soft, flute-like sounds. There are two kinds of harmonics. Natural, the more commonly used one, is produced by a gentle touch of the finger on the string so that it vibrates on both sides of the finger. The artificial harmonics you just heard are less common and are produced by two different fingers touching the string at two different specific spots. The passage is difficult to play, another technical demand on the player. Section B prime continues with the two variations of its theme, except that this time they are not entirely in solo violin. The first variation is brief and in solo violin. It is in D minor and marked affettuoso, affectionate with tender warmth in the score. It is slightly altered from its earlier version. The second variation, the full restatement of the theme, starts in orchestra with an antecedent to which the violin responds. After this, the violin proceeds with an extended recitation of theme 2. This is also varied from its earlier version. The momentum continues with virtuosic solo violin figurations. These involve fast runs of 16th notes and double stops that require big stretches of the fingers. The passage ends with a key change to D major. Now the tonality turns defiantly major, says Hurwitz. Solo violin climaxes with dramatic fortissimo double stops and lends on a fortissimo high D. The climax is accented by the full orchestra. Let's hear the theme 2 variations and virtuosic violin passage. Theme 2, first variation. Second variation starts in orchestra. Violin continues the second variation. fast virtuosic passage on violin. Violin moves towards a fortissimo high D. High D. Violinist Cotin Rack about the demands of this passage. Throughout these fast runs, articulation is a major challenge. It is difficult to project high notes with the violin, especially when the orchestra is also playing. Rehearsals 11 and 12 are very virtuosic and forte or fortissimo, a little bit cruel. Rehearsals 11 and 12 in the score represent the last two-thirds of the passage. Coda in D major. The brief coda begins with loud, rising music in orchestra in a dramatic slow crescendo accompanied by solo violin figurations. The orchestra repeats the rising music louder. Brilliant proclamations in brass and timpani suggest a happy ending, says Hurwitz. Fast solo violin scales alternate between major and minor. Hurwitz, the soloist protests, seesawing indecisively between major and minor in a series of tipsy chromatic scales. Solo violin soars to yet another climax, accented by three loud concluding orchestral chords. Here's the coda. The chopped-up way in which I presented the third movement does great injustice to it. We miss the effusive energy and non-stop momentum of the music. And that second theme is such a catchy tune that it crawls into your mind, constantly replaying itself. So let's hear the entire movement through and through. I will narrate the various parts. Section A begins with chugging rhythm. Theme 1, Polonaise for Polar Bears. Introductory gesture to theme 2. Theme 2 in orchestra. Note hemiolas. First variation in violin. Second variation in violin restates full theme. fast virtuosic passage. Get ready for the climax that ends the B section. A prime, Polonaise for polar bears. B prime introductory gesture. B prime theme 2 in bassoon. Violin in accompaniment. Artificial harmonics in violin. First violin variation. Second variation. Fast virtuosic passage. Violin moves towards the climax. High D, coda, tipsy scales on the violin. Some comments about the third movement, Tovi. With less than 50 lines of full score, the finale achieves gigantic proportions and brilliant high spirits without banality. Leighton. The whole finale has an infectious and irresistible sense of momentum, and even an inferior performance never fails to rivet the attention of an audience. About the demanding virtuosic violin figurations, Downs. There are incredibly difficult passages of thirds, arpeggios, harmonics, double stops, and a whole battery of violinistic fireworks. About the often quoted Polonaise for Polar Bears remark of Tovi, Tomi Makela, after pointing out that there are no polar bears in Finland, states, "The expressive character of the dance rhythm is by no means Nordic, but rather a mixture of Polonaise and Tarantella." Final comments about the concerto from violinist Miriam Cotan-Rack. Some violin music, for example Paganini Caprices, is composed mainly for technical challenge. These are usually short pieces, difficult to master, but not demanding on the endurance of the player. A concerto is not supposed to be about technicality, but rather about aesthetic beauty. Sibelius' concerto stands out by encompassing both. It is especially difficult because of its length, posing serious challenges to the stamina of the player. No wonder that Viktor Novacek, who premiered the piece, a violinist of inferior caliber, was reported to be, quote, red-faced and perspiring, unquote, and fighting a losing battle with the solo part. Miriam continues, "The level of violin playing at the beginning of the 20th century was not as advanced as it is nowadays. There were only a small handful of performers then who could tackle this concerto. Nowadays, given contemporary education and practice, a wide variety of violinists can handle it. I can just imagine how shockingly novel and difficult this concerto would have been to those who encountered it in the early 1900s, says Miriam. Now it is not. Additional final comments. Here's a quote from Robert Layton referring to Grieg's piano concerto of 1868. "Apart from Grieg, it is the only Nordic concerto to have attained classical status and universal popularity." And a final quote from Ledbetter. "A failed violin virtuoso is responsible for what has surely become the most popular violin concerto of the 20th century." Thank you for your attention. May I suggest that you now look for a recording of the work or go on YouTube, where you can find excellent renderings of the Sibelius Violin Concerto by Hilary Hahn, Maxim Vengerov, Sarah Chang, Anna-Sophie Mutter, and others. Farewell.